Thank you, Aida, and good afternoon to everyone. Thanks very much for the invitation to present at this workshop. I have very much enjoyed the three presentations in the previous panel, and I see some connections also with what I'm going to talk about. So I hope that we can continue the discussion that was started previously. So I have prepared a PowerPoint. I'm going to see whether I can share that with you. And if someone could please tell me whether that's...
Sure. Yeah, Elaine, we can see it.
Yeah? Great. Yeah. Yes. Okay, so codes of ethics and conduct. Well, actually, it's a very interesting phenomenon when we consider developments around the globe. We see that there's a proliferation of codes of ethics and conduct for legal professionals over the past decades. So here on the slide, I've projected a few of the older ones, which have inspired also the development of codes elsewhere in the world. So for judges, especially the Bangalore Principles of Judicial Conduct, which were adopted in 2002, have been, those were developed by a group of judges in the framework of the United Nations. But we can see also in Europe that in a lot of national codes, this document has served as an example. Another country where codes of conduct, codes of ethics have been developed already for a long time is the United States. So here we see that both for judges and for lawyers, the American Bar Association has played an important role. But I want to focus our discussion on Europe and European jurisdictions. And then to see what we can learn about the developments of these codes and how they can play a part in dealing with the current issues that judiciaries and also connected legal professionals are struggling with. So first of all, what are we talking about when we talk about codes of ethics? Interestingly, in comparison with disciplinary norms and rules, codes of ethics, they have mostly a positive outlook, and they present some aspirations for legal professionals on how to be a good judge or a good lawyer. And there we see that when codified, these codes of conduct, codes of ethics, they are seen as documents which can help to motivate legal professionals to be the best at what they what their profession requires. Those codes, they can also help them to account for their actions, because a lot of codes, most codes actually are public, are available on websites, and we can find English translations even of most codes of ethics for judges in Europe. A third function is also education. So it was mentioned previously already, in order for legal professionals to become the best at their job, education is important, and there these codes can also play a role. And finally, the codification of specific norms of conduct can provide an opportunity to innovate. So to set new goals, for example, for systems in transition. So I want to go a step further now in this presentation and consider the background of the development of codes of ethics for judges in Europe. I will mostly focus on judges in this presentation, but of course we can expand it to other professions. Then see what can these kind of codes offer in the European legal context, in terms of dealing with tensions on the rule of law and judicial independence in different member states of the European Union. And then as the last part of the presentation, I want to look at the specific content of a few codes and also present some insights on experiences with codes and make some suggestions for further empirical research into that. Now the background, first of all, so why do we have so many codes of conduct? I mentioned it's a global phenomenon. So over the past decades, we see that a lot of principles and standards for judging and for lawyering have been written down. In my current research, we have found for the European Union, for 20 member states out of 27, we have found published codes, and maybe we are still missing a few. Then it would be really helpful maybe also from this audience to receive directions. And interestingly, we see it's a collection then of values and principles, but especially in transitional contexts such as post-communist states, we see that codes often are more specific, setting out certain duties with the reference that the code can then play a role in evaluations of the performance of judges or prosecutors. Well, there's this tendency of writing down the values and principles. And here we can again make a link to this notion of social legitimacy of institutions. For judiciary specifically, I think we can notice that where traditionally legitimacy from the general public was a top-down affair. So judicial institutions had received authority from the powers that be, and that was enough for the people. We see that in the current society, there is this societal demand for transparency and accountability of institutions. And so judges, they are called for more to explain their actions, not just through their judgment and reasoning, but also in their conduct inside and outside of the courtroom. And here, ethical codes, they give them guidance on how to go about that. We also see that the increased complexity of laws and also of European and global interaction is another reason for codifying principles and standards in order to help legal professionals to navigate that complex landscape. Well, then in transitional context, I would say there's maybe an additional reason for codification, because it also allows for modification of the applicable principles and standards. And that's this idea of innovation of professional rules that I refer to. Interestingly, there's a transnational aspect in many of the codes, meaning that there are references to codes from other jurisdictions and also to European and global standards, such as the Bangalore principles. Almost all of the national codes that we found have been translated in English and published on websites, even the French one. So that's quite interesting that apparently judiciaries in European countries, they feel that there's a need or an interest to share their principles and standards with the general public and their peers elsewhere. And thirdly, there's a relevance to this codification when we look at ambitions of the European Union. And here I refer to the idea to an idea that was presented by the former EU Justice Commissioner Viviane Reding on the establishment of a European judicial culture. In a lecture that she gave, I think it was at the European University Institute in 2010, she presented this idea and said, well, if we really want European legal cooperation to work, we need to have not only the treaties and certain mechanisms of cooperation in place, but we also need to look at the underlying ideas and create shared practices. And she said, well, we need to take all the lawyers on board, judges, legal practitioners, barristers, solicitors, and law professors. So that's an idea of a European judicial culture. Here, I think that codes of ethics have a very good opportunity to make an impact, because those codes of ethics, they very much relate to ideas and values that we have of the judicial professions. So for judges, first of all, independence and impartiality, but also professionalism and integrity are covered in codes of ethics. Secondly, if we want to put those ideas into practice, codes of ethics already give us a first step of doing that, because they give more or less concrete principles and standards, and therewith a point of reference for judges and for judicial institutions to develop new routines. Of course, all of this depends very much also on the environment. So there should be an institutional environment which enables that kind of development. And here, the Guide to Judicial Conduct in the Netherlands is particularly interesting because the last section of that code sets out obligations for the legislature and the executive branch of government in order to enable judges to fulfill their professional role in the best way possible. Now, when we consider this concept of a European judicial culture, that also what the ethical dimension, then I would say we could consider that as one of the main pillars. The other ones are the legal dimension. So that's more familiar field, I think, for lawyers and judges. So that's about the rules and case law. But then there's also an institutional dimension, which is interesting. And that's what happens in European networks, because networks of judges, for example, they are a place where professionals can meet, learn about each other's background, and share their ideas and practices. So in my group, one PhD candidate, who you can see in the background on this photo, she's doing research into the practices of European judicial networks to see what is happening there and how that contributes to the realization of such a European judicial culture. Now, we could, of course, further discuss on whether it's actually a good idea and what we think of the EU's ambitions in this regard. For now, I think I want to emphasize that these networks, they also show that it's not just a top-down development from the European Union, who works with trainings and improvement of sharing of information, but it's very much also a bottom-up development from within national judiciaries, where there is, mostly in most countries, a small group of judges who are very much involved and active in building European connections. But then finally, let's have a look at the content of some codes of ethics. I'm still in the process of analyzing what we found in my project, so I won't be able to draw really general conclusions. But there are a few things that stand out. First of all, from a theoretical perspective, when we consider what are these codes? Is it kind of soft law, which then can be applied in evaluations of judges? Or should we rather see the codes as a description of soft skills, so skills that judges and other legal professionals should display in their work? In analysis that scholars have made, it has come to the fore that actually having more legal norms is not the most beneficial impact that code of ethics could have. So in quite a few systems, they are more seen as non-binding norms, which do help legal professionals to find their way. And then the skills aspect, helping judges, for example, to develop more moral sensitivity to the cases that they're judging and the context in which they do that. And also providing insights into also social psychology. So what do, for example, biases, what can they have as an effect in judicial work? How can judges deal with perceptions of procedural justice? Their coach can help them by giving very concrete guidance. So we could say that, in a sense, codes of ethics could help judges to ensure the moral quality of their adjudication, and here virtues come back. There's a field of scholarship which has developed a virtue ethical outlook on judging, and there we see that then general virtues which come to the fore are perception of what is required in the case, not just legally but more holistically. There's also the virtue of courage of judges, so to take difficult decisions even when there's pressure from the parties or the political and societal context. The virtues include temperance, so not dealing with the question to what extent judges can use emotions or show emotions when they interact with parties. Justice is also involved here. So this, the idea of justice, and that could be social justice, but there it depends also on developments and debates in society. And more legal virtues then are independence and impartiality. Now, when we consider how those kind of virtues have been written down in codes, we do see a difference when we look at two examples. So here is a first example from the code for judges and prosecutors in Romania. And there we see what the code actually is called a deontological code. So it says itself that it focuses more on duties. There we do see that the code sets out to describe criteria for evaluation of the professional activity of judges and prosecutors. So it's, well, they're more focused at describing really standards for performance, which can be evaluated. Then when we compare that with the Guide for Judicial Conduct in the Netherlands, we see that that, on the other hand, is much more open-ended, and it says it gives a framework for judicial conduct, but then gives responsibility to individual legal professionals to use that as guidance when exercising their duties. So here, I think it's a question that is still open. What is the actual... how can codes of ethics be used, actually? And I looked it up within the framework of the Council of Europe, that there are actually the Committee of Ministers in its recommendation of 2010 said specifically what there should be codes of ethics, which include principles, but also duties that may be sanctioned by disciplinary measures. So the Committee of Ministers seem to respond well also to the Romanian approach, whereas the Conservative Council of European Judges said that a code of ethics should be drafted by judges themselves and should be clearly distinct from disciplinary rules. It seems that also within that framework, there's a difference of opinions on this. And now to conclude very quickly, there's empirical work in progress on codes of ethics. In my own studies, I'm looking at experiences that judges have. Are they actually aware of the existence of a code? Do they consult it? Do they use it in professional debates? And what do they consider to be the effects in disciplinary proceedings or in internal evaluations of their work? Besides that, there is empirical work already, which is very interesting when we think of ethics. I just want to mention a book that came out earlier this year, which was written by Frans van Dijk, a colleague at Utrecht University. And his main question was based on surveys among different audiences on the independence of judges in European countries. Can we find that there's a lack of alignment or a disconnect between the judiciary and society? He did find in certain countries that yes, there was a lack of alignment or even a disconnect. What causes this? The empirical research does show that being transparent about what people can expect from the judiciary, well, that's one of the first starting points. And then judges showing that they account for other professional work, that's the second important thing to do. Now, to wrap this up, I hope to have shown that national codes of ethics and also European ideas about this, that they can help individual legal professionals just by giving them a very general guidance on values and principles for their professional role. But also these code of ethics, they clarify that there's demand for action also of other institutions, such as legislatures and the executive power to enable judges to do their work properly. And there in the European field, we see that codes of ethics, but also networks that they can help to create support from different other jurisdictions. Think of the March of a Thousand Ropes in Warsaw, that can actually put pressure on national governments to take up that role of creating the enabling environment. Well, and then finally, towards the general public, codes do help in creating transparency and accountability. I'm not fully optimistic because I think there are pros and cons of codification of ethical norms. A benefit is that we can clarify what they are and what they mean, and can then also develop shared norms across systems. But there's also a risk that they become hard standards and that they can play a non-intended or actually maybe an intended role in disciplinary procedures. So what's to do? I think continue academic and professional debates in which we learn more about the nature and usefulness of codes, thinking also in terms of soft law and soft skills, to further develop professional ethical thinking among legal professionals through knowledge sharing, but also through trainings, and to further reflect on the relevance of shared European norms and standards. Thank you.